The execution of Breath of the Wild story is very different compared to other titles within the Zelda series. Much of its information is found not from the game's characters, but the ruins and structures all across Hyrule. From the technology linked back to the battle 10,000 years ago, to the Forgotten Temple and Lanayru Promenade, said to be structures made by ancient Hylians. One area in particular stands out. North of Great Hyrule Forest lies an island shrouded in perpetual darkness. The Japanese name of this place translates to Duriburon Iseki, Duriburon being an anagram for the word Burundo, and Iseki directly translating to ruins. The localization gives it another name, Typhlo Ruins. Like many ancient ruins in Breath of the Wild, Typhlo holds one of the many shrines in the game. The player navigates a dark maze littered with ruins and uses the torches to light a path to the Kito Wawe Shrine. An orb must be taken from the Hinox residing there and put in the pedestal to complete the quest. The reward for this puzzle is the usual spirit orb and an ancient core. But what makes this location bizarre is how, despite solving the shrine's puzzle, Typhlo Ruins remains in a state of darkness. The thunderstorms of Thundra Plateau will cease once you retrieve that shrine's spirit orb. Same goes with the sandstorm surrounding the Dakota Shrine in the wasteland. No matter how far you progress, these ruins will always be surrounded by darkness. This has made investigating this location for all its secrets rather challenging. Even with the light from the torches, only bits of the area surrounding Link are visible. If we were to analyze these ruins, the ability to remove the darkness would greatly help both the speed and accuracy of research. And I'm pleased to say that after reaching out to a certain individual, this feat was made possible. Thanks to the user SchoolsOut1, we're able to use a cheat that removes the darkness effect of Typhlo Ruins. Now we can view it just like any other location from the game, both in the daytime and night. A link to his channel will be down below, and thanks again for making this cheat. Without the darkness, Typhlo Ruins looks like an entirely different area. Not even the map shows this level of detail as it's covered by dark clouds. Two things become clear about this area. It's filled to the brim with ancient structures, and all of the structures within Typhlo are associated with a certain tribe. The Zonai, a savage tribe that mysteriously disappeared long ago. Multiple owl and dragon statues are visible throughout the ruins, along with the pillars and wall you see in areas such as the Zonai Ruins. The sheer amount of Zonai Ruins is rather odd when you think about it. It's ironic that Typhlo has a higher concentration of Zonai structures than the Zonai Ruins themselves. Masterwork says nothing about this location, other than label it as Zonai Made. The same goes with Thundra Plateau and the Lome Labyrinths. Like other structures made by this tribe, it houses one of the 120 Sheikah Shrines. It's clear that this tribe was connected in some way to the Sheikah, but maybe not. Typhlo Ruins looks exactly as one would expect. It's, well, ruins. The collapsed and broken structures are testament to the passage of time. One object that's exclusive to this area is the very thing that guides the player through the puzzle. Small, bird-shaped torches. The design is somewhat similar to the owl statues. Because many of the shrines are found within Zonai structures, the idea is that the Sheikah had worked with this other tribe during the creation of technology 10,000 years ago. And yet, not a single thing is said about them in the present day, 100 years ago, or even in Impa's story. Possibility number two, the Sheikah found these abandoned ruins and used them to house some of their shrines. Only one quest contradicts this, the Fragmented Monument, with the assumption that this relic was built by the Zonai. Given the text's direct connections with the shrine puzzle, the fragment may have been created by the Sheikah to resemble Zonai architecture. The same applies with the labyrinths scattered across Hyrule, but that's another topic for another day. A first look at these ruins in broad daylight can feel overwhelming given the sheer number of statues and walls. People have tried to map out Typhlo Ruins before with fairly accurate maps. And here I was, able to view the ruins without the darkness. I couldn't give up this opportunity, and no one has really talked about this place before, so I did the only thing I thought to do. I went around the map, adding stamps to the walls, statues, pillars, and other important landmarks, took a screenshot of that, overlay the image with a high-res version of the Typhlo map, and add/connect the dots to these structures to make an ugly but accurate layout of the ruins. And thanks to Twitter user Hachimitsuka, the map was further developed to be a perfect scale of this location. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the map of Typhlo Ruins. We'll be referencing this map often in this video, whether it be strange details or important sections. Again, a huge thanks to Hachimitsuka for making it possible. A link to their Twitter will be down below. The first detail worth mentioning is the previously discussed bird torches. Whether they were made by this tribe or not is up for debate. Each of these torches is looking at another, creating a path that leads to the shrine. Some of the statues do stray away from this route, but are positioned as a way to guide the player back onto the main road. It's hard to believe that the Zonai, a tribe which may have existed long before the Shika, would position the torches in such a way. The shrines had been built sometime 10,000 years ago as a means of preparing for Ganon's return. The very purpose of these statues was to guide the hero through the ruins and complete the shrine quest, which brings up several possibilities. Either the Zonai created these statues, which were later moved to the ruins, or they were created by the Shika. It's worth noting that a similar puzzle is located within the Gerudo Desert, as the player traverses through a sandstorm in search of the Kima Zeus Shrine. Statues of swordswomen are used to guide the player in the right direction, described by Lane as remnants of an age long past. They certainly resemble Gerudo warriors, and have the exact same low poly design as the ones in Gerudo Town. It's very likely these were sculpted by this tribe, and later moved by the Shika. Therefore, perhaps the same can be said with the bird statues within Typhlo Ruins. Both the Zonai structures and torches are covered with moss, though given the short time it takes to grow, in comparison to Breath of the Wild's thousand-year gap, it doesn't really help in pinpointing the time these statues were made. One thing these ruins do tell us is something I mentioned long ago in a Blood Moon video. Ganon's power is said to peak during the events of a Blood Moon, capable of reviving fallen enemies, and creatures such as Stalkoblins and Stalfos only appear during the nighttime. At first, one might assume Calamity Ganon's power is dependent on the time of day. We do see this in other titles such as Ocarina of Time. The Stal children spawn in Hyrule Field only during the nighttime. And yet, the player can find Stalkoblins within these ruins, no matter the time of day. Therefore, Ganon's power isn't dependent on the hour, but the level of darkness. What's strange is how, despite the ruins being filled with Zonai structures, only two of the statues make an appearance, the owls and dragons. The third animal, the boar, is nowhere to be seen within Typhlo. In fact, only eight are found within Hyrule, all in the Faron region. Only one of these appears in their major ruins, close to the Spring of Courage. The other seven are technically within Zonai territory. There are sets of pillars on the far left and right of the woods that mark the beginning of their region. Once the player passes them, ancient relics of this tribe are visible on both the roads and hidden under vegetation. The rest of the statues within Zonai ruins depict one creature, the dragon. This section deep in the forest is said to be holy ground of the Zonai tribe. Out of the three animals, this is the one revered most. Second appears to be the owl, with its several appearances in Faron, including some that act as offering, and of course, the few within Typhlo ruins. In comparison, most of the boar statues can barely be seen. Several of them are buried within the ground, as if they've been forgotten. In addition, we only ever see the head. The same is true with the owls and dragons, however there are many cases where a body is present. They are the only ones that can be described as statues. None of the boars are ever paired with a body. Much of Typhlo Ruins remains a mystery, and even now I'm not sure as to what it all means. But there are many areas worth discussing, some with possible answers, others, I'm not too sure. To the upper left of the ruins lay a perplexing puzzle, a luminous stone surrounded by six dragon heads, all placed with precision circling the rock. Something similar appears outside of Typhlo, in the Faron region. There's a lone boar statue to the northeast of Sarjan Bridge, which is surrounded by six pillars, one of which has fallen down. Given how the Zonai's animal motifs represent the three different virtues, and that boar is for power, this arrangement could be a retelling of the events back in Ocarina of Time, Ganon being sealed by the sages. Not only that, we've seen him transform into a boar-like creature in many games, the best examples being Ocarina of Time and Twilight Princess. Some have also suggested that the fallen pillar may represent the water sage killed by Ganondorf during his failed execution, though it could be a coincidence. But if this arrangement is of these events, what about the one within Typhlo Ruins? Instead of six pillars surrounding a boar, we have six dragons circling Luminous Stone. Six links? The dragon is associated with courage, but that's not much to go off of. The Luminous Ore may be key to understanding this mystery. Their pale blue glow is rumored to be souls of the dead. If the ones from the trailer are indeed Lumina Stones, there may be a connection between these rocks and the Forgotten Tribe. It might even tie into their disappearance. More of the Lumina Stone is scattered across these ruins. Another ore deposit is positioned below a tree, and many of the individual rocks are atop structures. The most interesting ones are those within the eyes of an owl and dragon statue. Typhlo Ruins is the only location with this odd combination, but it doesn't mean there's a connection between the stones and this tribe. What makes these ruins unique is the darkness which covers it. Fire is used as a way to navigate the maze, giving a source of light to the player. Chances are the Lumina Stones were added for that exact reason. Not necessarily because a connection exists between the two. Another item that glows in the darkness, the Silent Shroom, is found within Typhlo. I'm not saying that the Lumina Stone aren't related to the Zonai, but that their appearance within Typhlo can't be used as evidence to prove a connection. The darkness surrounding Typhlo may have been a creation of the Sheikah for the sake of the trial, similar to the Thunder Plateau or Sandstorm of the Gerudo Desert, as they vanish once the shrine quest is completed. Or perhaps the Zonai were, in fact, alive at the time of the technology's creation and cast spells upon their own ruins. After all, they are implied to be magic wielders. The luminous ore surrounded by dragon heads could simply be hinting at the answer to the shrine's puzzle. To conquer the darkness, one must be guided to the light. It would explain the eyes of the owl and dragon being luminous stone. Notice how no boars are present within these ruins. The bearers of the Triforce of Courage and Wisdom are the ones which defeat evil. In other words, darkness is defeated by light. Some of the statues around Typhlo are submerged within the swamp encircling the ruins. At one time, this moat may have been empty. Many of the structures are either knocked over or broken. One worth mentioning is the owl statue with luminous eyes. It's not shattered, but sunk halfway into the ground. Perhaps this was smashed into the earth by the Hinox living here. There's one room with three dragon statues, though aside from how random it looks, doesn't appear to be of any importance. To the north of Typhlo lay a group of dead trees and grass, and it's the only part of the ruins which features this vegetation. The use of fire is vital in this quest, hence all the torches and elemental weapons. Perhaps an accident occurred, leaving part of the ruins burned. Typhlo is also west of Death Mountain. Debris from the mountain's eruptions in the present day could have potentially damaged the ruins. Similar trees are found between the mountain and Typhlo. In addition to this, if we are to assume that the moat was empty at one time, one possibility is that either the Zonai or Sheikah constructed it to trap any flowing lava from Death Mountain in an attempt to preserve the ruins. Typhlo Ruins continues to be one of the game's strangest locations. I can't help but feel unfulfilled with the results, even after hours of research. It feels like there's more to this puzzle, that the dragons surrounding the luminous ore means something much deeper. Whether this is connected to the sequel or not, we're just gonna have to wait and see. Thank you all for watching today's video. If you guys don't know, a massive theory discussing the Zonai is in the works. It's going to take a lot of time to put together, but I promise it will be worth it. Thanks to all of my patrons, including those who simply watch my videos. It's what keeps me going, and I promise that there's more Zelda content to come. Don't let the countless streams of Animal Crossing and Persona 5 convince you otherwise. I've been Nintendo Black Crisis, and I will see you all next time.